healthy church, sitting in the back row, opening the hymnal. I tried to melt the words. I know it's been a while since I was a child, and I might remember though, that was many years ago. And Lord, it's been far too long since I sang this song. This broken man needs to see how great thou art. My past is darkness, need to find forgiveness. It's time to turn the page. That's when I came across a song about the lost saved by your amazing grace. How sweet the sound, how great. And Lord, it's been far too long since I sang this song. This broken man needs to see how great thou art.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming out to Faith Worship Center again. Some of you guys are just getting to be regulars. You were here yesterday. No one was here. You mean next week's conference with Randall Worley? Oh, yeah. We weren't here yesterday. We'll be here this coming Saturday, though. I'm sorry. That's such a drag. You're such a faithful, amazing person. Thanks for coming out yesterday. All by yourself. Bless you. Glory. Well, whether you're here by yourself or we can all worship and love the Lord together. Let's do that in worship today.
Let us shout, be your anthem. Presence of my enemy. Oh, my church on. Thank you. Your name is life. Your name is hope inside. It's hope inside. Your name is love, a love that always finds, always finds. Your name is life. Your name is hope inside. It's hope inside. Your name is love, a love that always. Oh, your name.
Only one who could ever see. Worthy
every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you. Holy and holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are in. Every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me. Thank you. and I will not be shamed. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. You will not be shaken.
Thank you.
child of God. Come on, you split. You split the sea so I can walk right through it. My fears are drowned in perfect love.
I'm no longer, say every voice,
that I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Oh, I am a child
of God.
I'm no longer
a slave to fear.
I am a child. I'm no longer,
and I'm no longer.
Hallelujah. Amen. We are child of God. Thank you, Jesus. Being a child of God, I wrote this prayer this morning, and I wanted to decree it and pray it with you, our family, today. So, Father God, we thank you for our ability to come to your throne of grace today, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in this time of need. We pray for our country, the United States of America. Everything that can be shaken is being shaken. We thank you, Lord, that you have not given up on America, but through prophetic words you have spoken that you are cleansing our land. Things are being revealed that until now have been hidden, but you are bringing it all out in the open, so that you can judge and remove the evil. We say yes to you, Lord, and repent of any part we have done or not done to bring about this evil. May we have your courage, your wisdom, to walk out these days in the beauty of your holiness. We invite you, Father, Jesus, Holy Spirit, and the seven spirits of God, the Spirit of the Lord, wisdom, understanding, counsel, might, knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. Come into our land. Let the atmosphere be transformed into your living heaven. We pray for the United States of America to be a shining light on top of a mountain, shining life, liberty, and justice to all the world. As you are removing the lies in our own lives, as well as in our country, we decree Psalm 68:1, let God arise and his enemies be scattered. We pray for our President Donald J. Trump and his cabinet. We pray they would have the mind of Christ in all decisions that are being made now. We pray, Lord, for safe and honest elections this coming November, and that you are the one who rules and reigns over our country. Your name is above all names. You are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We bless and honor you, Lord, and we pray that you would, God, bless America, one nation under God.
Wow. That's our head intercessor right there. That's pretty awesome. Every time I think about the politics, I think of Daniel and how irrelevant kings were when it comes to the plans of God. You can always go to God. You can always pray the kingdom of heaven. It just overrides everybody else. I love it. Those in politics would probably find it disconcerting to be that irrelevant, but it doesn't matter to God. It just doesn't. So we can pray that. We can pray that and not be political, because we're kingdom-minded people. So thank you, Sim, for that reminder and that passion. That passion. Yeah, so thanks a lot for coming. We're going to, I don't know how to transition on that. Thanks, so you can go now. No, I'm only kidding. Well, actually, you could. You can go anytime you want. We just want to take a break, I guess. Let's just take a breather. Greet each other as you feel comfortable doing so. And if you brought kids and you want to hang out with other parents with kids, you can use the back corner of our church. Often, before COVID, it was the children's section, but those rooms are available for you, parents to hang out if you'd like. And if not, you're more than welcome to stay here. So we're just going to take a few minutes, kind of transition into the message. If you have an offering, you want to bring it forward, you can do that now. If you want to give online, instructions are on the wall. And we'll see you guys in a little bit. Okay. Welcome back, everyone. Just so that you're aware, we still technically are, we don't have internet at the church. It's still down from last week. We are working on a long-term solution. And what's awesome about technology is it'll leave you hanging like that. But it also, we also have other options, which is kind of cool. We have a, you know, someone's using their cell phone as a personal hotspot, and we are doing a live feed, but it does drop out once in a while because of that connection is not always as secure. So if you're watching online, we also have additional phones just running a live feed from the back of the auditorium, back of the sanctuary. What is this place? Back of the room. So we're covered. Everything's covered. Technology's awesome. It comes and goes. It's still awesome. any announcements? Oh, yes. So this Saturday, we have Healing Rooms in the as well as Randall Worley going on Saturday. They both start at 10 o'clock. So Randall starts at 10 to noon. That's his first session. Healing Rooms is also 10 to noon. They mostly work out of the function room. So they have, you know, if you want to go, you can come to both. If you feel like you want to go to the Healing Rooms during, before Randall, do so. But Randall will be in here from 10 to noon as well. Then we'll take a little break. He'll be back again from 2 to 4:30-ish. And then we'll take a break, and then we'll be back on Sunday morning. That's a really long break, but technically we'll be back again on Sunday morning. It's kind of fun. Since the whole Rona opportunity has given us, it's like, wow, like this is our first conference in a long time. We're all kind of like amped up. Like, I need to find help. Oh, I need a volunteer. Oh, so it'll be fun. Get us all back in the groove. It'll be fun. What else is going on? Offering, I covered that. Rent, huh? A Wednesday, this Wednesday, thank you, love. This Wednesday is your last opportunity to ever pray. September is our call to prayer, and after that, it's over. So, no, it's not. Well, yeah, after that, September's over. That's true. That's the last day of September. So, if you haven't been, you should come. It's really fun. If you have, like, trauma from previous prayer meetings, I've been there. These are good meetings. You'll actually, this will bring healing. It's like a prayer sozo. If you have bad memories of of a whiteboard and lots of unspoken requests or whatever, and start to twitch, come to our prayer meetings. You'll enjoy them. We worship for like an hour, so it's pretty awesome. I just think worship's always awesome. I'm moving this, which means all the camera guys are going to be like, oh, no, now his head's cut off. Anyways. How to transition from this to that? I don't know. Oh, foolishness. Yeah, that's a good one. All right. I want to look at a passage today that ties into a whole lot of stuff. So I'm just going to... I have a train of thought that this works. So there's... no, you don't. You see, I practiced this seven times, and each time it went different. And now I'm up here for number 8, and it's still coming out different. So now I don't know what to do. The presence of God. There you go. That's a good entrance. Okay. So the presence of God. Presence of God, it's such a Christianese phrase, right? What is that? It's the presence. Ooh. And then if you really want to get Christian-y, you go, it's the manifest presence. I got chills. They're multiplying. It's a horrible musical to bring up on a Sunday morning, Bob. Yeah, I know. Okay, Daryl's not here, though. He's at a wedding, by the way, just in case you were wondering. Goslin's daughter, Michelle, got married. You know, it was supposed to be a big thing, and then COVID shut it down to nothing, and they said, you know what, we're going to do it anyways. And they did. They went out on a beach with just a couple people, including Daryl, and had a wedding yesterday. And they're going to celebrate next year, I guess. But anyways, just so you know, that's where he is. And I'm jealous because I love doing weddings. But it's fine. I would do everybody's wedding. I just love them so much. I'm actually excited because I have a wedding to do next August. And I'm already like, this is so exciting. I love doing weddings. So anyway, nobody you'd know. It's just I get to do it. I'm pretty fired up. Sorry. See, Bob, you transitioned into your message. You transitioned right back out. And now you got to get back in. Oh, presence. So the presence of God, you get chills. There are all kinds of, it's just a, really what it is it's an awareness of God already being there. All right? He's already there. He never leaves. I do understand that we use vocabulary that makes it sound like he comes and goes, like we're waiting on him to show up, or when you walk into the room. Like, I understand that the awareness makes it seem like you're the constant one and he's the one who comes and goes. But trust me, it's the other way around. He's the one that's never left. Your awareness of him is what starts to shift. And as we move into a greater awareness, that's called like growth and maturity and opportunity. And that's all something that we all can get better at. Now, sometimes people will use an event or a circumstance, and they make that their spiritual identity. That becomes who they are. And nobody here, but you might know people like this, right? They've gone through something, and it seems like every time they talk to you, that's what they talk about. That revelation, that healing, that experience, that circumstance that changed them, whatever. And that becomes their whole world, and that's what they build their life around. But it's not their identity. It's not who they really are. Because who they really are is the gospel of Christ. It's the grace of God. That's what the gospel does. It brings back to you all that your Creator created in you. It makes you fully aware of God's presence, and it puts you in a place where you just cannot get away from Him because you're that always connected. Okay. Whew. Just realized I was screaming at you. It's okay, Bob. They're nice people. I know. I just get so excited. Okay. So I want to read for you a passage in which, I think a lot of times this passage has been used to manipulate, but that's true with just about the whole Bible. It's whatever. Most people that use passages to manipulate people's behavior are doing so from a heart that they really, honestly, I believe they really want to do the right thing. They're trying to do the right thing. But often, your perception of God changes the way that you perceive and interact with Scripture. So if you think God is disappointed in you and gets angry with you and wants to slap you or whatever, then when you read Scripture, you read that into it. And so it's easy to do. And I don't fault you for that. None, again, sorry, I keep saying you, like any of you have this problem. I don't fault people for doing that. I really don't. I know their motive is they really want to know what God's saying. I trust that in them. So when I read Scripture, the first thing I read is I read from a voice of joy, because in God's presence is fullness of joy, and guess where He always is? In His own presence. So I'm guessing it's a pretty happy voice. That's just the way I perceive it. So I want you to know that as I'm reading this passage, this is what goes through my head. I read a passage and I hear the goodness of God. He's always been good. I don't use it as a band-aid over a bad thing. Something bad happens to me, I don't say, oh, well, God is good. It must be good. Bob, it's bad. It's not bad. God is good. He did this to me. No, I don't do that. I know God's goodness is going to override these circumstances. That's where the goodness of God comes in. He didn't do the bad thing to me, but man, He can short circuit what the enemy wanted that bad thing to do to me. He can totally revive it, reverse, he can do something different with it. And he can make it amazing. And but that doesn't mean he did it. And that's where it gets, I know it gets confusing. I do. Because you think, but because of this bad thing, all this good stuff happened. So God didn't do the bad thing. He caused all the good things. That's what we focus on. He's not going to give you cancer so that your family gets back together. He doesn't do that. But if you got cancer, he'll either heal you and or bring, I mean, he can do it all. His goodness is always there. Okay, that's not your message, Bob. I know. Read the passage. Okay, so this is the passage. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. I'm going to start with a piece of verse 7 where it says, I humble myself and honor you by preaching God's good news to you without expecting anything in return. Verse 10, as surely as the truth of Christ is in me, no one in all of Greece will ever stop me from boasting about this. Then I'm going to read, then verse 16. Again, I say that don't think that I am a fool to talk like this. But even if I do, listen to me, as you would to a foolish person, while I also boast a little. Such boasting is not from the Lord, but I am acting as the fool. And since others boast about their human achievements, I will too. The boasting about human, it's easy to read that concept, that, you know, you're boasting like just, he's just being arrogant. Like that's boasting. But that word boasting means rejoicing. It means if I'm going to be happy about something, I'm going to be happy about all kinds of things. And there's a lot of people that get all in their glory about human achievements. I don't like boasting about my human achievements. That's what Paul's saying. I just don't like it because to me, it doesn't make a lot of sense to just tell you all the stuff I've been through. I'd rather tell you about the gospel. I'd rather tell you about who you are in Christ. I'd rather tell you about the grace of God that gives you the power to act out the power of God on this planet in everyday life. That's what I'd rather do because that's where the time is better spent. But if I have to tell you about my human achievements, I'll do it because it seems to be something you're very interested in because there's a lot of people around you that seem to be, that you seem to be captivated by because of what they've been through. They've had an amazing spiritual experience, and they've told you about it, and you're like, oh, ooh, I want to be like that. Or they've been through something really difficult in life, and you're like, oh, that's horrible. I want to hear more, which is always interesting concept when somebody tells you something horrible, and you're like, yeah, tell me more. And then that was your thought, Bob. You shouldn't have preached that. I know. I didn't realize that until it was coming out. Okay. They have this amazing, you know, spiritual revelation, and they build a life around it. He's like, listen, all that is legitimate. I understand. It's not like things don't happen to them, but it's not their whole identity. It's not their whole identity. But if you need to know what I've been through, I will tell you what I've been through so that you can just have a list of stuff that I've been through. It's not that it's not real or valid. It just doesn't have a lot of value when it comes to knowing who you are. Because if I tell you all the stuff I've been through, it doesn't necessarily make you identify with God more. It doesn't pull you into your identity more. There's things we can discuss that will allow you to walk out who you are. And that's what I want to do. And I've done that. I've been in counseling sessions with people multiple times, right, over and over and over again. We're working through stuff, and you know, we get all done, and everybody's happy. You know, we've done, whatever, 12 sessions together, and when we walk away, you know what they don't know about me? Lots of stuff. Not horrible things, just they don't know the foolish things. They don't know my favorite color. They don't know what I like to have for dinner. They don't know what kind of movies I like, because we didn't discuss those things. That's what Paul's talking about. He's like, if you want me to discuss foolish things, senseless things, things that aren't going to really matter to your identity, I can do that. But just know that that's what I'm doing. I'm just giving you a list of stuff that really doesn't matter to your spiritual walk. I'd rather boast. I'd rather rejoice. I'd rather emphasize the gospel of God. I'd rather emphasize the love of God. I'd rather make you more aware of his presence because that's what's going to change your life. My experiences don't change your life. It's what helped, what God has used to change me. Whew. All right. Here we go. So he gets a little distracted for a couple of verses, which I totally relate to. And then he says, but whatever they dare to boast about, I'm talking like a fool again, sorry. I dare to boast about it too. Here we go. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants of Christ? I know I sound like a madman, but I have served him far more. I have worked harder. I have been put in prison more often. I have been whipped times without number. I have faced death again and again. Five times the Jewish leaders have given me 39 lashes. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. I've traveled on three times I was shipwrecked. Once I spent a whole night and day adrift in the ocean. I have traveled on many long journeys. I have faced many dangers of rivers and from robbers. I have faced dangers from my own people, the Jews, as well as from the Gentiles. I have faced dangers in cities and in the deserts and on the ocean. I have been faced with danger from men who claim to be believers but are not. I have worked hard and long and endured many sleepless nights. I have been hungry. I have been thirsty. I have often gone without food, which I think is the same as hungry, but that's okay. I've shivered in the cold and without enough clothing to keep me warm. Besides all this, I've also taken care of multiple churches around the world who are, and if there's anyone feeling weak, I feel that. If they're led astray, I get angry. If I have to boast, I'd rather boast about how weak I am. Oh, yes. Bless Jesus. And I've heard this passage. I mean, honestly, that list of things is insane. That's like me going, I have a friend, I've had this happen, right? Go to a friend, I'm like, hey, so I got a chance to sit in a single engine airplane. It's pretty cool, right? And my friend goes, yeah, but I'm a fighter pilot, jet fighter pilot who served in the war. And you just kind of go, yeah, well, I guess you win. So this is kind of what Paul did, right? Because there's people in Corinth that have made a ministry out of one revelation. They've made a ministry out of one bad experience. They've talked about how difficult it is to lead a church. And Paul's like, I lead hundreds of churches. They spent one night imprisoned in their house with a cold. He's like, I have been in prison many times. I have been beaten many times. You got slapped once. Somebody slipped, spit in your face once. Like, by the time he's done, everybody who has an experience in which they have built their identity around, it kind of like, yeah, well, maybe actually he's done more than I have. And Paul's like, listen, I'd rather boast of my weakness. And this is where a lot of preachers would be like, they usually preach against other preachers in this passage because some other preacher got a bigger TV program or their book hit the bestseller list or whatever. Then all of a sudden it's like, well, I would never boast. I'd rather boast in my weakness, so-and-so, Bill Johnson, he's whatever. He's just boasting. He's promoting himself. Or, Elevation Church has got 47 albums out this week, and they're boasting about it because they're promoting it all over the internet. And that has nothing to do with what he's talking about. You can promote whatever you do. Don't feel bad about it. You can lay that all out. He's saying, if I'm going to just tell you about my experience, I can do that. If you want me to rejoice about my experience, I can do that. I had a ton of them. He goes on, I didn't keep reading, but in the chapter he's like, if you want revelation, I've had hundreds of them. I've literally spent so much time in heaven, I can't even tell you how much time I've spent in heaven. That's literally what he says. Like, you get one dream and build a ministry. I literally have spent 3 years in the desert with Jesus. Give me a break, guys. This is not about revelation. This is about the gospel. This is about our identity. This is about who we are and our perspective. And our weakness? Our weakness is not something that is physical, although technically that word can mean that. Our weakness is not something I'm not good at. The weakness is something I want to become better at. If you break down the word,
That is there. It's something that you look at and you say, you know what? I know a little bit, but I want to know more. I know the love of God this much, and I want to know it this much. I've done this much, and I want to do even more. My weakness is, that's what he's talking about. It's the more. He's like, you want me to boast? I want to talk about what, I'll boast about where I want to go and what I want to do. I want to become greater at these things. It doesn't matter what I've done. I want to do more. That's the weakness that he's talking about boasting about. He's not talking about, oh, humble me. I've got an eye problem. My leg hurts. My arm hurts. Woo! He's excited. And he's not belittling these people. He's not making fun of them. He's not doubting them. He's not mocking them. He's letting the Corinthians know. He's letting the people that all the people who read this and others who maybe are in this mindset of boasting about what they've been through, he's like, focus on the right thing. Get your perspective where it needs to be. Because in those things, Christ will be uplifted. The glory of God will come down. Sorry, I just used that same vocabulary, didn't I? I made it sound like the glory of God isn't here. The glory of God will be exposed. People will become more aware of him. I mean, where did he get that kind of perspective? Well, I'm glad you asked. I had to just pick one. I just had to pick one. But honestly, Paul's just the shipwreck things alone. Think about if Paul wasn't mature. Now it's different, right? A lot of people think spirituality is maturity. Right? They get to hear from God. They hear from Holy Spirit, which is a good thing. I don't want to mock it, but I am going to kind of poke fun at it. It's good to hear from Holy Spirit. But some people get there and they think, oh, that's fine. I don't need to talk to nobody now. I don't care what anybody says. God told me. God told me I can do what I want. God told me. There's no maturity. There's no loyalty. There's no stick-to-itiveness. Oh, life got rough. God's moving me. I'm leaving. Oh, I had an argument at church. Oh, I'm never going back. God's leading me somewhere else. Oh, I got uncomfortable. Oh, see you, bye. I don't feel safe here anymore. You know, I don't feel safe. I mean, God is showing me that maybe I need to go where I feel safe, where I can really worship him. And I just smile. I mean, you can't argue with God, right? And they heard him. So they're not hearing you. Trust me. I tried. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. No, no. God told me. God told me. Because they equate spirituality with maturity. If you put 90% of those people in any one of these circumstances in which Paul had worked his way all the way through, they would have bailed. I've called to Rome. Oh, shipwreck. I am called back to Israel. See ya. He would have never wrote half the books. He would have never been in prison. Because he would have been like, oh, nope, they're mad. People are mad. I'm leaving. God's called me elsewhere. They just don't receive the message. I have a revelation that's only meant for people who get it. They don't get it, so I'm leaving. I don't know why this guy, I don't know why Paul has to talk like a California Valley girl. I don't know, but it works in my head. Yeah, I'm sorry. He can talk like whatever you'd like. He probably talk like a Jewish man. And I got to work on my accent for that. I can't think of the word I want to say. Imitate, thank you. That other voice in my head was like, imitate, Bob. The word's imitate. I can't imitate a Jewish man, so I don't sound like him. But Paul sounds like a valley girl to me when I hear this. So, most people who aren't spiritually mature would have never gotten the resume that Paul had. Because they would have bailed every time. And it would have been God's fault, trust me. But Paul, who I know was originally named Saul, who was probably named after Saul the king, because they both came from the tribe of Benjamin, just for what it's worth. He had a perspective that allowed him to go through difficult circumstances without losing his identity, because that's what his connection was. His connection was so tight with the presence of God. He was so aware of God's presence within him that when bad stuff happened, it was like almost irrelevant. The guy floated in the ocean for almost 2 days. He lands on an island, he gets rescued from that, and he still goes on the missions trip. Who does that? You say, well, he was a saint, Saint Paul, the divine. Yes. Yes, God calls you a saint too. So guess what? You can become just as aware of God as Paul was. He's powerful. This is a powerful opportunity. So this is I picked one story. This is the one where he's on a missions trip. I think it's his second one. He's preaching day after day, and this is Acts 16. That's the one I landed on. So I'm gonna hit verse 18. That's not the verse I'm gonna stick on for long. It goes this day this. So it talks about the fact that he's preaching the gospel. You're going to tell the whole story anyways, aren't you, Bob? Yes, I am. Sorry. I'm not sorry. It's just, anyways. So he's preaching the gospel day after day. There's large crowds around him. Of course, when you have large crowds, people show up and want to sell stuff. It's bizarre, but it happens. I remember we had this 40 days of worship down in Connecticut. I was a part of, and I went to all kinds of them. I went to so many of these nights of worship that my bosses back at the church were like, how do you have all this extra time, Bob? Like, what are you not doing that you should be doing? You have all this time to be at worship every night. But that was another discussion. Back to yours. But people would show up with, like, coolers, and they'd sell cans of soda and water out of them for their church. There'd be, like, little signs, like, whatever, on the cooler, and then they'd sell. Crowds of people show, they're like, oh, I can sell something. There's nothing wrong with it. It's just, for me, it's just, I don't think that way. So I think, what are they doing? They're selling candy out of their trunk. This is like a worship night. What are we doing here? But then later when I'm hungry, guess where I want to go? Yeah, I want to go to that guy's trunk and buy a Snickers bar. So I appreciate what they're doing, but it just seemed, so the same thing happens. The fortune tellers show up, large crowd of people, and the girl that they have that is connected to the devil, the enemy, is telling fortunes for money, and they're making money. This goes, listen, why I highlighted verse 18 is this went on for day after day. Paul lets this go on. He lets a demon-possessed girl walk around his ministry. Mm-mm-mm, not here, not in this house. Boy, we'd have somebody with essential oil be sprinkling that lady all over the place. We'd have the myrrh mixed with the sapphire and a little provolone, and we'd be throwing that on them. Shaka-boom! I'm only kidding. I'm sure the essence of frankincense will bring peace to my... All right, so I just think, when I read that verse, I think, wow, was he patient? Because this girl, when she wasn't... Now Irene's laughing, it's making me laugh again. All right. I just realized, like, there's about 17 relatives of mine that are like, if they hear this message, they're going to be like, what are you saying? I don't know what I was saying. I was just having fun. Relax. Provolone, Bob, that's cheese. <I'm> sorry. If Daryl's watching this, he's going, this is why we can't leave him alone. All right. I need to be on the front row. Okay. The patience of Paul, though. The patience of Paul. Day after day, this girl's following around saying, I command, you know, saying these people preach the gospel, basically. She's saying these people are from God. This man is of, you know, knows God. So she's not telling a lie. I mean, the devils know who Jesus is. They know he's the true Messiah. They get that. This is what I think Paul is constantly aware of. That his presence forces that presence to constantly glorify God. He's not afraid of this demon. He's not thrown off his groove because somebody's freaking out. He's like, man, God's presence is all over this. They literally can't say anything that I'm not saying. They're literally preaching the gospel, the demons are. Do you have any idea how frustrating that must have been for the devil? Do you have any idea? He's like, I got this girl possessed, and now all she does is preach the gospel? I mean, honestly, that's funny. You picture him downstairs. I don't know why. down in his office going, what is going on up there? I thought we had her. Well, we do have her. Well, what's the problem? Well, you see, when she gets around Paul, the presence of you know who just is really powerful. Like, we God. But because she constantly is doing this, there's people who are not aware of the presence of God within them. They get disturbed and start to impact the ability of the gospel to get out. So Paul does the most loving thing he can, and he releases her from that prison. And he says, you know what? It's time for you, demon, to leave. And it does. I don't know where he goes. I'm sure he was in trouble. That part, I'm sure. Paul gets thrown in prison because now the money's gone. The moneymaker's done. I'm sure she had a great conversation with Paul and Silas, though. I'm sure she hugged him and laughed. To be out of that bondage had to be amazing. The whole city was in an uproar. Paul and Silas get thrown in prison. And then verse 25, around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening. You see, circumstances shifted dramatically. Paul's reaction wasn't, oh, I think God's calling us elsewhere. It was just like, well, we just stay connected to the presence. It wasn't that Paul, we don't have record of this that we know of. It wasn't like Paul got a word of knowledge. If you worship, I will bring an earthquake. Paul's like, oh, we've got to make something happen here. Paul and I were just singing and praying like they would all day. They didn't start at midnight. It was when they just kept on. That was part of their life. The presence of God, they understood the power of constantly releasing the presence. They knew that it would shift the atmosphere. They knew it would change their circumstances. They're sitting in a dark, rat-infested... Sorry, I was going to start describing scents and the smells, and I thought, don't do that, Bob, it's church. But it smelled bad from other things that had gone on in that hole that they were in. None of that impacted their ability to take deep breaths and sing. None of that impacted their ability to pray. See, they were mature people, not just spiritual people. Where did Paul learn all of this amazing priority of presence? He learned it from his family. He learned it because in the Jewish world, their ability to understand and maintain the connection to their heritage and to their history is vital to them. And as a rabbi, Paul would have been fully aware of how important the presence of God is through the story of David and the story of the Exodus. Understanding that before they would go out into the battles, right, Judah would be the lead tribe. They shouldn't have been because they were the fourth born child. But God put them out front because he wanted to illustrate what? That praise goes first into battle. That's what Judah means. Praise goes first into battle. National battles, cultural battles, community battles, personal battles. Praise goes first. And the Levites, what did they do? They surrounded the Ark of the Covenant. What did that represent? That represented the presence of God. We are called the priests. Their job, the Levites' job, is to protect the presence. And they didn't do it by singing. They surrounded it. They gave their lives for it. They protected it. It's an amazing illustration. Whenever the Ark of the Covenant would come into a battle, people got inspired by the presence of God. They gained confidence in the presence of God. They sensed the victory. The story of the Ark is an amazing narrative to track through Scripture, especially because of what it represents. But know this, it's not a magic box. Just starting out with worship and praise doesn't mean you're going to win the battle. Just having the Ark in the battle doesn't mean you're going to win the battle, because they lost it. Remember, they lost the Ark. Samuel brought the Ark into battle. Everybody's hooping and hollering. Philistines get nervous. They're like, oh my gosh, they brought the Ark. We're going to lose. And it says one Philistine stood up and said, no, if we focus, we can get them. And they did. And they stole the Ark. Then they had other troubles. Again, this is an awesome story. But they basically put it on a cart and put a big ox in front of it, and they just let it go. They were like, let God decide. Let their God decide what happens to their Ark, because we're done with it. And it wandered back into Israel. It wandered into a village area, heavily wooded plateau. And it stayed there for 70 years. Samuel, the guy who lost it, never went back to get it. I don't know why. Saul, who was king, never went back to get it. I don't know why. David finally goes to get it. Not as soon as he gets crown king, but soon after he finally takes over Jerusalem, which of course had never been operated by the Israelites until David had taken over. And that's another whole story. And why did David go after this? That's the point I want to get to. I believe because David had a vision. I believe David had a revelation of worship in heaven. And the revelation in heaven around the presence of God goes 24/7. And David saw that. And in his heart, he became impassioned with the idea that when we have the city, the capital city, when we have Jerusalem, which I also believe David was shown to be the city of God, where God was going to set up a unified nation, when he was a shepherd boy, he got that revelation. And we can go into that scripture too, but it's just, I don't have the time. But trust me, he got a revelation. He knew 24/7 worship is the standard in heaven, and I'm going to bring heaven to earth. And he went and he got the Ark. I know the first time the party ended really quick, which had to be devastating to him. 30,000 troops. That's a parade. All kinds of people showed up to walk this cart from the woods that where it had been hiding, not hiding, but where people kind of knew where it was, but nobody went near it. They were going to walk it all the way to Jerusalem, a big party. You don't think the enemy was freaking out? He knows what that represents. He kept it in the background for 70 years. And now David's turning it into this huge opportunity to bring the presence of God, the awareness of the presence of God. I know it looks like he's like showing up with the presence of God like God was in the box. He's not in the box. He's bringing the awareness of the presence of God to the capital city for 24/7 worship. And the enemy took one opportunity, the only opportunity he could find. He took that one opportunity and he killed the party. And Uzziah died. And the ark went into a barn or shelter or something was created around Obed's house, right? Obed of Edom. Who literally was just a guy like watching the parade go by his house. Like he had nothing, had no idea what just happened. I mean, picture what he went through, right? He's watching the parade, everybody's partying, there's 30,000 troops all around, drums are banging, trumpets are playing. All of a sudden, one guy dies, the party's over, and that whatever that is just shows up in your house. I literally could spend 20 minutes on what was probably going through his head. What do you do with that? But this is what Obed did. He housed the representation of the presence of God, and he did so with honor. And God blessed that house. And David went back to his house, and he probably started cracking the books. He was like, what in the world did we do? How did we give access to the enemy? And they were like, well, actually, we didn't carry it the way that God told us to carry it. We carried it the way the Philistines did. David's like, what in the world was I thinking? Why didn't we read this beforehand? We're like, well, literally everything was going so well. Like there wasn't anything that David was trying that wasn't going well. So, you know, when things go well, you just think, God, I'm good. Everything I do is good. So David gets it right, and then he redoes the whole parade 3 months later. Obed had a decision to make. Let the ark go and turn the presence of God into an event or go with it and turn the presence of God into a lifestyle. Obed and his sons are listed as worship leaders in the tabernacle of Jerusalem. He took the presence of God and it became a lifestyle for him and his family. He took the blessings that happened at his house and he turned it into a blessing that could happen for his house and the houses that came after him. It became a heritage. I don't know why that hit me so hard. Holy cow. That's what Paul was aware of. He was aware of the presence of God is something that you nurture. It's something that you go after. It's a sign of maturity. It's not a flippant decision. It's not an event. Your awareness of his presence is something that you can constantly become more of, which is what's called boasting in your weakness. You can say, I know a lot about it. I'm aware of it most of the time. And then I get cut off in traffic and I am out of the presence. And then I get right back in. Good. I'm glad you get right back in. Some don't. Some spend the whole rest of the day because that event becomes their identity. And now there's somebody who got cut off in traffic. And they're upset the whole rest of the day. And they're going to tell everybody who comes to them about how upset they were. Or maybe it's something that blessed their socks off. But they don't see the presence of God in it. They get distracted by the amazing, you would not believe the size of the hot pretzel I got. It was so good. Oh, I got to tell you about this place. Or the barbecue. I did go to a really good barbecue place the other day. I was like, oh, we are coming back here. Yeah. At least 8 times, because that's how many things I want to try. I literally stood and looked at my wife. I'm looking at the menu. I look at my wife. I was like, I can't be here all day. I have to make a decision. Because I would just sit here all day and try everything. It was so... Anyways, enough about me. You could turn that kind of blessing, that kind of event into your identity. He's like, no, become aware of God's presence. Become more aware of God's presence. So I did. I was like, God, thank you, God, for barbecue. Oh, it's a glorious thing, because this is how everything I do can become an act of worship. Because I'm aware of God's presence in everything I do. I do not need music. And that, again, goes to that whole maturity concept. It's some people, you know, people are like, well, I just need to worship. Everybody out of the room. I need 2 hours alone so I can really get my worship on. Listen, that's fine. I'm glad you know what you need. But trust me, that's not, you can do it other ways. There are other awareness opportunities, other ways to focus. If that's the only thing you got, great. But develop some more. Because Paul worshipped God while he floated in the ocean for a couple days. When he got shipwrecked 3 times. While he's being beat with a whip 39 times on 4 separate occasions. He never lost the awareness of the presence of God. He could have turned his whole ministry into his first encounter when he was knocked on his... On his knees, when he was knocked over by God's light and blinded by the light and then received his sight 3 days later. He could have turned his whole ministry into that testimony. And he didn't. Because he understood this is about a lifestyle, not an event. And no matter where you are in your walk with God, you can become more aware. Other writers and amazing revivalists have talked about it as, you know, the veil gets thinner and thinner. Easier and easier to move. The curtain isn't as dark. It's just, you can just step into his presence so simply. We've been around those people. We've had them here to speak. It's just, desiring that is called boasting in your weakness. It's called moving towards something greater to bring more glory. It's a great thing. You know, what David set up in 24-hour worship, 24-7, I mean, it's insane. The logistics alone are insane, but 4,000 singers, or, sorry, 280 singers, 4,000 musicians, 4,000 gatekeepers. They were like the production managers. They oversaw everything, including 4,000 temperamental musicians. And the one poor drummer who was better than everybody else that everybody wanted in their band. I mean, I get a head rush thinking about all the logistics of this. But he set a standard that literally is the standard for revival throughout the rest of Scripture. Every king that revives the nation of Israel, it's noted that they brought back the worship as it was in the days of David. That awareness, that 24/7 awareness of God's presence is the standard for revival. So you can get distracted in this world. There are circumstances all around us that can steal our awareness. And trust me, that's what the enemy wants. Or you can seek a greater awareness and become like Paul. Where you can say, yeah, we can talk about foolish things, things that really aren't going to matter. We can talk about that. We can talk about the weather. We can talk about politics. We can talk about football. All good things. Not evil things. Not sinful things. Just things. Or we can talk about things that really matter. We can really go after. We can rejoice over stuff that's going to really change. And allow us to become more of who God created us to be. And allow us to bring revival to this land. That's all I got for you guys today. I hope you have a great evening.